I'm going to close with a quick story from a combat mission, and then I'm going to share some of my thoughts about why you need to vote for me. So people have asked me, you know, because sometimes it's hard for them to understand what is an A-10 mission and what was your most complex mission. And there's many of them. They're all complex in different ways. But the most complex was one where I was diverted, as we often are. You take off on any given day and you don't know where you're going to go when you're doing close air support because there's Americans under fire and they need your help. So I was diverted to help a team who had been out to do reconnaissance in this very difficult, winding canyon in southern Afghanistan. And I, as a squadron commander, I was in Afghanistan commanding my squadron, and on my wing, actually was my boss on his first combat mission ever in Afghanistan and ever in his career. And so we fly in twos, so you always have a wingman with you to support you and make sure they're looking for somebody who's shooting at you and to protect you as you're rolling in. As a flight lead, you're responsible for figuring out where is everybody down there, what's going on, whether to employ weapons and how to employ weapons. And I showed up to help these guys out. They had been ambushed. When they finally pulled out my map and I was able to plot where everybody is, there was friendly and enemy all surrounding each other in every direction. There was no front line like where we try to train to, where you try and shoot the gun parallel to the friendlies. There was no possibility to do that, and with the terrain it was very difficult. They were low on ammo, they were low on water, and they were needing our help. They were literally climbing up the sides of this canyon trying to get away as they were surrounded. And so I had to come in after I marked looking at the target. I was like, how am I even going to hit this without impacting killing Americans? Because fratricide is such a high risk when you're in this situation because they were so close. So I came back around and I marked the target with white phosphorus rockets, which we do in order to make sure that's exactly where we're shooting. And as I shot the rockets, they said, no, the enemy's closer to us. They're closer to us. And so I had to come back around a second time. And I thought, man, these guys are so close. But I had to shoot the rockets again. When I shot the second time, they said, that's the target, you gotta take them out, they're coming after us now. And right at that time, my heads up display completely died on me, like completely died. I had a failure that they said, no, we're never gonna have to deal with something like this in combat. We have four levels of degradation, and this is what we call standby pipper, which is like World War I technology, where you're just dialed out a pipper and it's all just physics. You've gotta arrive at the right point in time, at the right airspeed, at the right altitude, at the right distance from the target and shoot the gun at the right second, corrected for winds and other things in order to hit that target and not hurt the friendlies. And their lives were all at stake. And we used to argue when I was instructor pilot that we would never ever have to employ standby pipper in combat, so why were we even teaching it to our students? But there I was. So I came back around, I did what I was trained to do, like many American men or women doing right now overseas today. It's not about me, it's about the amazing training that I've got in order to be a fighter pilot, to be able to have discipline and courage under fire to do the right thing when lives are seriously at stake. I came back around, I lined up, I got myself on a good base, I rolled in, I checked everything as I could and I was trained to do. I opened fire and I took out the enemy. And I came back around and did it again. We ran out of gas, we were relieved by some guys from my squadron, and we got all of those Americans out safely that night. Okay, and I mean, this is the kind of stuff that's going on right now in America. And I'll use an analogy. We're in Washington, D.C. right now. Lives are at stake. We got the enemy surrounding us. We got friendlies whose lives are at stake. Americans' lives are at stake. Our future is at stake. Our systems have failed us. Okay, so we are down to the standby pipper right now of how our founding fathers have designed our government to be, what the constitutional principles are, and how that's supposed to be executed, and it has failed us right now. And so we need leaders, and we need people with the experience and the moral courage to do the right thing at this unique and pivotal time in history in Washington, D.C., in order to get the mission done and save the lives of Americans and get us going in the right direction. This is serious business. I know you all know that or you would not be here. What is it that distinguishes me from the other candidates? You have to look at two things. One is our records. I have a record of almost 28 years of serving my country at the highest level as a commander in combat. I'm responsible to not be a hothead, but to be cool under fire. I'm responsible to make sure that my people are trained and disciplined, and I know how to lead a disparate group of people to get the mission done. As a colonel, I have led the planning and execution for border security operations, for counterinsurgency operations, and for counterterrorism operations all over the world. As a colonel, you have to understand what is the right thing to do for our national security. How are you going to get it done? Strategize it, plan it, get it up through the chain of command, get it approved. And I've done this in my last job, specifically at Africa Command. I led a counterterrorism mission effort that I can't talk about or I'd have to kill you all. But you have to, as a lead, I had to work it through the Department of Defense. I had to get it through the Department of State. We had to get it through the National Security Council. We had to get it approved by the President. And then we made it happen and we executed that mission. And so there is a difference in our backgrounds. And serving as a commander, serving as a colonel, and the education experience I have, I understand the things that are facing our nation right now. I have worked on Capitol Hill. Frank is talking about he's the only one who has experience. The United States Congress is not the state of Arizona Senate. It is not. They are addressing very different issues, as they should, because of the 10th Amendment. The state issues are not the federal issues, and as a federalist who understands what we need to do in America right now, you need experience in the U.S. Congress. I have experience in the U.S. Congress. I worked there for a year. I served under a man who I saw his character and experience that has mentored me so that I understand how to get things done and how to lead and how to educate your colleagues and how to get things accomplished. I personally have shown I could do that when I got the Abaya legislation passed. So please do not confuse the issues. The Arizona State Senate is not the U.S. Congress, okay? The issues that are facing our nation are issues on the macro level. You need to have that big picture and global understanding of the things that will turn our economy around, get the federal government off the backs of small businesses so jobs come to America versus India. We got to make sure we're addressing these key national security threats that are impacting our security and our freedoms all over the world. A potential nuclear Iran, what's going on in Syria, what's happening with the countries that are transitioning in the Arab Spring, what's happening in Mexico. You have to understand these international issues that are facing our country if you're serving in the U.S. Congress. I have that experience. I'm the one who can get things done there. I've shown that and I've demonstrated it. You do need to hit the ground running, and you've got to know how to get things done in the U.S. Congress. The last thing is, we've got to win this election on June 12th. This is not about picking your favorite horse for April 17th. This election is of national level importance. It's the only election going on in America, and the nation is watching to see. And this is a Republican district. Before the lines get redrawn, it's a Republican district. So we need to win this seat. And we need to then have an incumbent when the district lines are redrawn so that we still have a CD2 Republican in office. So back that up. We got to make sure we have the right candidate who can beat Ron Barber. We have sensitivities in our community right now that you're all aware of. We have been through a very tragic time, and there is a story behind that. But, you know, me serving my country is something that I just did because it was the right thing to do. But the reality is I have a story to compete with the story, if that makes sense. I mean, I have a story of a pioneering spirit who has served my country, whose father died when I was 12, who's going to put my life on the line, who has put my life on the line, who will stand up for what's right, and you know, served in combat, is a veteran and is a leader, and I have that story. I can beat Ron Barber. So I need you to strategically look at that as you're making your selection. I have put my life on the line for the oath of office. For 26 years, I took that oath of office to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that I take that obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, and I will well and faithfully discharge the duties of the office I am about to enter, so help me God. This was my officer oath. I put my life on the line for it, I put my career on the line for it, and I will do it again in Washington, D.C. Please vote for me to represent you. Thank you.